Good evening and welcome to the Thursday, December 8th, 2016 meeting of the Northampton School Committee. I'm Mayor David Narkowitz, the chair, and we'll begin the meeting by having the clerk call the roll call of the school committee.
Dr. Thomas Barrett?
Here.
Ms. Molly Brown?
Here.
Ms. Rebecca Zgansky?
Present.
Ms. Laura Fenton?
Present.
Ms. Downey Meyer?
Here.
Mr. Howard Warren?
Here.
Ms. Denari?
Here.
Mr. Everett?
Present.
And Mayor David Narkowitz?
Present.
Your honor and the floor.
Thank you very much. We'll now begin with the public comment period, and we have a sign-up sheet, and we would ask folks who've signed up to come to the podium and state your name and address, and we have one person signed up, Gina Norton-Smith.
Hello. My name is Gina Norton-Smith. I have a son at Northampton High School. I live in Northampton on Murphy Terrace. Last Friday, I found out about a program the superintendent, Dr. Provost, and the Northampton Police Department are starting called High Five Friday. Each Friday, an NPD officer will stand at one of the four elementary schools' doors to greet students. The program's purpose is to, quote, build on the friendly and positive relationships that the police department has / hopes to have with the students. That's the end of the quote. I can tell this program was created by well-meaning people who understand there's a problem in our society where large segments of the population don't trust and feel threatened by the police and vice versa. And no matter your politics, that's an important premise that we probably all agree on and we need to keep our attention on. While I appreciate the effort to address this problem, I and many of my colleagues, and I will say as the parent of a student of color in Northampton schools, I feel this approach is ill-considered, tone-deaf, and potentially damaging. The idea seems designed to create an opportunity for a warm and fuzzy moment with a feel-good viral video type takeaway, but it's all form and no substance. It doesn't get to the root of the problem. Going back to the premise of distrust among many people and many police, I urge the school committee to deeply consider these questions. Why would it be appropriate to put children at the center of this healing effort? What is the effect of for many parents and school personnel, let alone children, to arrive at a school door and see a police officer stationed at the door? In the era of school shootings and violence, I can tell you that no parent wants to see a police officer at their school door. If a parent in this room got a phone call from a friend asking, why is there a cop outside your child's school, wouldn't it cause you concern and fear? How does this effort comfort or reassure those children who have experienced trauma? And we have students in our schools who have experienced extreme trauma in their young lives, for whom a police presence is alarming and triggering. For children from immigrant families who feel particularly vulnerable and threatened, if not downright unwelcome right now. How does this plan feel to the many parents and children of color who know that the city could not even hang a Black Lives Matter banner without controversy and pushback? How will this feel to our new neighbors, those refugees we're expecting from war and refugees from war and state-sponsored violence? Most importantly, were any of the families or communities whose relationships with the police are in most need of repair consulted on where or how to begin the healing? I urge you to go to these communities in a spirit of honest inquiry and receptivity before instituting this program. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who wishes to speak during the public comment? Yes, ma'am. Again, if you could just state your name and your address for the record.
Yes, I apologize. I didn't know there was a sign-up sheet. My name's Bonnie Devlin. I'm from West Springfield, Mass. Here tonight as a representative of a program that National Grid offers, and I've spoken to a few of you through email. We're just trying to make sure that as many school districts are able to take advantage of this program. It is a fully donated program from National Grid. I am aware that it's a very short window that I have, but if you don't mind me just reading a little about it. It's an educational fundraising program enabling schools or nonprofits to raise funds while teaching about energy efficiency and conservation. The program is targeted for grades kindergarten through 8, but we also have youth nonprofits and high schools available to participate. It includes a free launch event presentation that is an energy efficiency and conservation show for elementary school kids. It involves a goofy wizard that they seem to enjoy. We actually have done it here at JFK a few times now, and once over at Leeds. So participants learn and become energized about selling energy efficient products and are encouraged to spread the word on ways to save energy at home. It is, again, as I mentioned, donated fully by National Grid, so the schools keep absolutely 100% of all sales and proceeds made through the fundraiser, and there's no charge at all for any part of the fundraiser. So I appreciate this opportunity to just mention it to you folks and to the Northampton community. And we're happy to speak with anyone who might be interested. We do ask that you call, it's a toll-free hotline number, 1-877-E-STAR-4U, or 1-877-378-2748. Thank you. Have a good night.
Thank you very much. Okay, is there anyone else who wishes to speak in public comment? Okay, hearing none, do we have any announcements from the school committee? No announcements from the school committee. We'll move on to recommended actions, and we have a consent agenda this evening that consists of the minutes of the negotiating subcommittee, November 9, 2016, the superintendent evaluation team, November 17, 2016, and the negotiating subcommittee, November 28, 2016. We have field trip requests, the NHS track team going to the MSTCA Winter Festival track meet in Roxbury, Massachusetts, December 18th. We have the NHS Girls Track going to the Rhode Island Classic Track and Field Invitational in Providence, Rhode Island, December 27th, and the 8th grade course going to New York City on April 26th in 2017.
Move to approve the consent agenda.
Second. Second.
Okay. We've been a motion made and seconded. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, the consent agenda is approved. We'll now move into reports and recommendations, and we'll turn to our student representative, Elena Fragamini.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for having me again. Happy December. So at the high school, we are fully into our third quarter and our winter sports season. We have our first basketball game this Friday in Amherst. If any of you feel like going and supporting the basketball team? So as you are probably aware, the district has been working on incorporating technology into classrooms under its Future Ready goals. And Ms. Todd Hunter, who is a history teacher at the high school, recently gave her History of the Holocaust class this opportunity. Her class received the opportunity to speak with a Holocaust survivor, Michael Krause, through using Skype. This is an incredible opportunity for the class and a lot of students at the high school. Because of Mr. Krause's age, he wasn't able to travel to the high school, but through using Skype and other technologies, he was still able to speak with them. So that was a great opportunity. In response to the election, students at NHS have been motivated to create a variety of politically active clubs and groups. Students are currently working to form a Young Democrats Club and a Youth Activist Coalition. And post-election, the social justice clubs at NHS, which include the Students of Color Alliance, Feminist Collective, Gender Sexuality Alliance, and the Environmental Club, have been taking a variety of actions. They placed an announcement on the electronic sign in front of NHS that read, quote, students, NHS students stand in solidarity with all in our community, unquote. They posted a sticky note wall where students and staff wrote supportive messages, and they are currently working with Superintendent Provost to create a document with local hotlines to be put on the Northampton Public Schools District website in order to ensure the safety and comfortability of all Northampton community members. Recently, the Northampton High School Quiz Bowl team competed in the Burlington High School Academic Tournament and came in second place out of 48 teams, so congratulations to them. And on November 22nd, Northampton High School welcomed Evelyn Harris, a Grammy-nominated composer and vocalist for the 2016 Goldstein Assembly. Ms. Harris's performance at NHS was made possible through the Daniel Stephen Goldstein Fund for the Arts. This was a fund that was created in memory of a student who had a specific passion for the arts. And each year, the fund allows for a professional artist to come offer workshops to art students at NHS and give a performance for all students. So again, that was a great opportunity, and we all enjoyed it. So thanks to that fund, and thank you all.
Thank you very much, Elena. Next, we have vote on the NEF small grant awards. And before we turn to Dale, I wanted to allow our colleague, Ms. Burnham, to make an announcement.
I'm going to be stepping down during this vote and abstaining from vote because I am one of the recipients of the grant, and I spoke with the Ethics Commission, and they said that I should do that. And actually, I'm going to step out of the room.
Okay.
So if somebody could get me when it's done.
See if we remember.
Don't want to.
Stay in Florence. Okay. Okay. So now, Dale Melcher of the Northampton Education Foundation.
Thank you. It's a little disconcerting to have people leave the room. So once again, I come before you with a list of grants that the NEF, the Northampton Education Foundation, would like to award as gifts to the school system and ask you to accept these gifts. I want to just share with you some background information on these grants. We have been doing considerable outreach for the past couple of years to really get into the schools and talk to teachers about both the small grants and our endowment grants. And we have been very successful. This is a good news, bad news situation. The good news is we once again had a large number of grant applications, 23 applications, requesting a total of $72,000+. Needless to say, we did not have $72,000 to dispense, and there were many, many worthy proposals, and we were not able to fund them all, and for some of them, we were not able to fund them fully. And it's distressing, as I'm sure members of our small grant committee, Laura Fallon, and our wonderful new student, Elena Fragmeni, can share with you. So I'm going to present 10 grants to you for a total of $25,650. And I would also let you know that the NEF, I'm going to keep saying the Northampton Education Foundation, because we feel like the community may hear NEF but not know what it is and not know that the money for these programs comes directly out of the pockets of contributors. So any ideas you all have about how to do better outreach and how to get more money into the pot to dispense to the schools would be welcome. So the first grant, you all have this, right? So I can just be very brief. The first grant is to Bridge Street School for a project called Folk Tales and Puppets for a total of $1,500, and that would be working with an artist in residence to make puppets integrated into the folk tale curriculum. The second one is also a Bridge Street School grant. It's called Dance Who, What, Why. It's a proposal for a 3-year program. We are funding year one, and the folks who applied for the grant have been told that there is no guarantee that the second or third year will be funded. And this is a broad look at dance, what it is, who does it, why we dance. The third grant goes to Jackson Street School. It is called Promoting Racial Literacy for $2,000. Again, Jackson Street School will be continuing the work it's already been doing on looking at race relations. Not only did we fund this grant, but we are suggesting to Gwen that possibly the school system thinks about coming to the endowment committee with a proposal to do this school. The fourth grant is to Leeds. It's called the Red-Backed Salamander Study, and it's working with Ted Watt, a naturalist at the Hitchcock Center. The fifth grant is JFK Day of Service. This is year two for this grant, and it's building on the very wonderful, very exciting work that the middle school did, also with an NEF grant, to engage the entire school in a day of service. The sixth grant goes to the Northampton High School for a peer mentor program. We're very excited about this program as well. It will identify students who are at risk and coming into the high school and pair them with student mentors in a program overseen by a peer mentor advisor and supported by training. The seventh grant goes to Ryan Road and Leeds. We'll begin our joint grants here for a program called Summer Reading Success. This is year two of a grant. We were very excited about the feedback that Mary Beth O'Connor and Rachel Ellis got on year one, and we're happy to be funding it again. Grant 8 is for youth farm field trips. It involves all the elementary schools and JFK. I want to point out that this grant funds buses, something we don't normally do, except they were able to find other sources of funding for all of the more academic parts of this project, and so we felt like we could stretch our guidelines and fund buses. But we would just like to once again flag for you all that a significant part of a number of the grant applications that we get is for transportation, primarily buses. And it's painful to give, you know, half of a $3,000 grant for buses. The ninth grant is called Sojourner Truths Florence, A Walk Through History. This is year two. We're very excited to be supporting this ongoing collaboration between the Sojourner Truth Committee and the folks who do the history of Florence, and particularly the Underground Railroad, anti-slavery aspects of Florence history, and bring that alive for our students. This will go to Leeds, Bridge Street School, Jackson Street School, and the high school. The final grant is called Improv Out. It goes to Jackson Street, Leeds, and again the high school, and this will work with, this will bring in people who have been in the schools for a long time, Heidi Haas, Molly Burnham, and Lisa Papadimitriou, to use improv techniques and improv work to stimulate the creative writing process. So the Northampton Education Foundation asks the school committee to please accept these gifts.
Thank you very much, Dale. Could I get a motion on that?
Make a motion to accept the NEF's Northampton Education Foundation small grant awards.
Second.
Is there a second? Okay. Any discussion or questions?
Other than just the comment of just how unbelievably wonderful these all are in terms of, you know, engaging students from all ages in single projects and all sorts of taking advantage of many of the local resources in terms of the fact that we are in Northampton. It's just really great.
I'd just like to say that some of the ones we weren't able to fund were also really wonderful, and we regret that we can't fund them all.
Okay. So all those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. The grants are gratefully accepted. Thank you. Thank you, Dale. Next, we have a report. This is from Lori Farkas and Pam Plummer. It's the social, emotional, and behavioral needs and supports in the Northampton Public Schools.
Turn that over. Thank you. Okay.
You can come back, Molly.
Yeah.
Thank you for having us tonight. Pam and I are excited to do this presentation and to share with you our thoughts, our information that we have on this subject that is really near and dear to our heart, our hearts. We are here to talk about the social, emotional, and behavioral needs and the supports in Northampton Public School. I'll start out by saying a little bit about why we're here. Our special ed numbers have not gone up significantly, but the need throughout the district, not just in special education, has. The need for related services, the needs around psychological disabilities, the needs of our English learners. Combining these needs together is happening, and the level of rising need is happening throughout the state. The state includes this initiative, social, emotional, and behavioral learning, in and around its work in response to intervention. And we have also included it in our district improvement plan. Those things together, the work that the state is doing, the work that they're supporting superintendents in doing, special education directors, have really propelled us into gathering and examining data related to students' social emotional needs and learning. Our goal tonight is for you to hear about the realities of our students and educators that they face every day, and to elaborate on the supports we provide and to set the stage for effectively planning the future. We believe this work is a moral imperative. We are not the only school district that is facing an increase in social emotional needs. We want to be seen as a community that values social emotional needs just as much as we value the academic achievement, and to know that they go hand in hand. Every day, we are immensely grateful for the compassionate and skill of our teachers, our ESPs, administrators, related service providers, our van and bus drivers, clerical staff, custodians, and cafeteria workers who are committed to meeting the wide variety of needs of our students.
So tonight what we want to do really is to validate their work and the commitment that they have to our students, and also help provide evidence and rationale for why we need more and they need more support in order to meet the needs of the students in our community. We'll introduce some strategies that we're using, some protocols that we've put in place, but in no way is this list comprehensive. It doesn't capture the myriad ways that we address the social-emotional needs of our students every day, but it's a brief overview. It's just the start of a conversation, and a conversation that needs to keep moving forward. As we make this presentation, we want to ask you to keep in mind a visual that might help you imagine what participating in school feels like for some of our students every day. In a book called The Heart of Learning and Teaching, Compassion, Resiliency, and Academic Success, there's a sentence in one of the very first pages that says that for students who've experienced trauma, for which we have many in our district, focusing on academics is like playing chess in a hurricane. The question is, what can we do to appropriately support these students? So if we go to page one. Some of this is based on a presentation, and you can see it's actually included on one of your last slides, that Dr. Provost and Sal Cannata and I did for the superintendent's conference that took place on the Cape this summer. Another presentation happened when Kathy Casal, who's a psychologist here at the middle school now, she and I went to a workshop for districts who received the Safe and Supportive Schools grant, and one of the school districts said, well, one of the things we've done as we were reporting out is we've presented our work to our school committee. And so Kathy and I looked at each other, we're like, oh, maybe we should do that too. So a lot of this is just sort of a summary of what we've been doing. Again, it's just a snapshot, but this was part of the research that we provided. We just wanted to include a sort of a commonly understood definition of social emotional learning, so we all started off in the same place. So the process through which children and adults acquire and effectively apply the knowledge, attitudes, and skills necessary to understand and manage emotions, set and achieve positive goals, feel and show empathy for others, establish and maintain positive relationships, and make responsible decisions. More and more, if you start doing research into this work, this meta-analysis that took place in 2011, that is up there, that looked at 270,034 K through 12 student programs. This programs for that many students, 270,034 students. They looked at universal programs that followed this particular these requirements. They were sequenced, active, focused, and explicit. And when they looked at all of them, the important thing to remember is these are universal. So these are classroom-based universal strategies that are implemented by teachers. One of the things that people tend to look at is not only did they have social and emotional benefits from participating in these programs, but also the academic performance that reflected an 11 percentile point gain in achievement. That gets lots of superintendents' attention across the state. That certainly, for me, isn't the only reason why you would do this work, but it is an interesting outcome. One of the other aspects of this meta-analysis that was really interesting is that the best benefit was when the interventions were provided by classroom teachers. Didn't matter if you had expert researchers and graduate students coming in to do these programs in the classes. The kids that did better were the ones that worked on this with their classroom teachers in their buildings. And I think that speaks a lot to the work that we do in our buildings on a regular basis. The programs themselves are helpful, but really it's the relationships and the consistent daily habits that our teachers have in place and the students, the relationships that the students have, how we arrange our classrooms, how we modify our expectations for work completion, and how we value and allow multiple means of demonstrating knowledge. Those are all pieces of it. So Lori's going to go next.
So why is it compelling to more closely examine social-emotional learning? As we've said, we've seen a steady increase in student mental health needs over the last 5 to 10 years. This has been evidenced by younger children needing hospitalization and significant mental health and behavioral supports, a higher rate of school avoidance due to anxiety or other mental health issues, resulting in an increase of home hospital tutoring needs. The development at the state level of wraparound mental health behavioral health services for students and families, and different models being instituted through the Department of Mental Health and Children and Families due to the level of need. And we are seeing, as we keep mentioning, increases in classroom behavioral needs without clear antecedents. This need is widespread and has resulted in conversations and trainings at the state level among superintendents, student services directors, and teaching faculty at all levels in an effort to access data, propose solutions, and develop and then implement training with the goal of not only addressing the immediate needs, but developing methods of assessing and remediating student social-emotional needs. And in remediating, we're going back to that educating piece that Pam was just talking about at the classroom level. So in our district, we began to look at social emotional learning when, we didn't begin, but one of our, we made it more formalized when we developed our district improvement plan. And so that was a year and a half ago, and I think it really was really forward-thinking at the work of the group that did that, that developed the district improvement plan, to realize that we needed to gather data and then create a unified, consistent model at the elementary schools, and that included screening, progress monitoring, and then intervention support. And the overarching piece, too, is education.
So I think the presentation tonight is it's a fine balance of sort of the realities and the hard parts about what some of our students face, but we also want you to hear about some of the really amazing work that's being done and that people want to do moving forward. And I know every day I feel incredibly grateful to be part of a community that values this so deeply that we're making it part of our everyday focus. So one of the first things we did was we knew we needed, in order to have an effective response to intervention system around social, emotional, and behavioral concerns, was to identify a universal screening tool. And it's important to remember it's just a screening tool. It's not a diagnostic tool. One really neat thing that happened was John Provost and I went to a presentation at UMass. It was actually for school psychologists, which is what my training is. And it was on social emotional screening and interventions, and I was pretty lucky to be the only school psychologist in the room that had my superintendent with me, which was pretty astounding. Other places just couldn't believe that he was there. So when we were listening to it, some of the things that came up were some of the strategies that we're putting in place to some degree, but also there were three or four screening tools that were mentioned. This one was mentioned as one that was very well researched. It happens to be free. The organization that puts it out is based out of England, and really the if you go to their website, the purpose is really to just try to help kids, essentially. And there's lots of research articles that are done around it. It ends up, I show you a picture on the next page. It has a teacher version, a parent version, and a self-report version. At the elementary levels, we had the teachers fill them out, and at the preschool level, we had the teachers fill them out. And just recently, this fall, the middle school had the students do the self-report. So we'll talk a little bit about it. But we wanted to show you, all of this can be found online through the link, the sdqinfo.com. And you see the kinds of questions that are on there. It takes a little while per class to do. It depends on how quickly people move, but I heard anywhere from 30 minutes to an hour to complete a class. And once we score them, we get a sense for where kids fall on the categories of, I'll go back now, hyperactivity, conduct, pro-social, peer problems, emotional, and then four of those categories, hyperactivity, conduct, peer problems, and emotional, are combined for a total difficulty score. There's also an impact statement, an impact supplement that will allow you to implement it after an intervention takes place. We have not done that yet in any of our buildings. So once that happened, we ended up organizing the scores, and I want to be super clear that none of those names on there are real. I spent a lot of time making up fake names. So, what happens is we went through and we would create a spreadsheet that showed from most amount of difficulties to least amount of difficulties for each scale for every building. We also organized it by classroom. So what you're seeing there is what a typical teacher might receive in terms of results. And the highest level is the red, is considered a very high level. The next level is considered high. The yellow is considered slightly elevated. And the green is average. And you can see that for the spring of 2016, we had approximately 26.9% of students with elevated scores outside of the average range at the elementary level. And this fall, we just recently did, the preschool results came back at 41.7% elevated, and the middle school self-reports actually looked pretty good with 12.8% to 17.1% elevated. So I want to talk a little bit about what the process looks like, because this really is just a conversation starter. What happened in most buildings, and I was lucky to be able to participate in it in most of the buildings, and just yesterday I sat through this meeting at the middle school. And I just want to say that participating in those conversations just is such an it was so inspiring to see how deeply our educators care for our students. And as we would talk about the kids, how much people know about our students, from their academic skills to their social emotional to their friendships to their families. We have a tremendously committed group of educators. What this does, having this data right here, is it takes what a lot of people already know and just helps organize it in a systematic way, and it helps you put it in a manner that allows you to have conversations about systems that we have in place and about resources that we have, about pockets where there might be a classroom that's really struggling in this particular area this year, and how we think about it as a group. So as a large group, most buildings had a team of people that came together to look at that initial set of data that involved all these various people, assistant principals or principals, adjustment counselors, school psychologists, nurse, tiered support providers, student, one of us, our BCBA, our district outreach social worker, Kelly Knight, I think has been to every single one of them, guidance counselors at the JFK level. And what they would do is they would come to the table with this data, but also with nurse visit data, office visit data, discipline data, attendance data, and start at the top of the list and start going through and say, all right, is there anybody on here that we don't know? For the kids that are on here that we do know, do we have plans for them? Do we feel like we need to tweak them? And just really systematically go through and have this be just a conversation starter. And for some kids, it helped bring up new ideas and new conversation that was very helpful. Let me go to the next page. The next step varied a little bit per building and hasn't yet happened at JFK, which is figuring out how to provide and review the classroom data with the classroom teachers or with the grade level teachers or the teams at the middle school. And again, I said emphasizing the importance of this as a conversation starter. And it was interesting to go through this process and watch a couple of the conversations with teachers, because some of them really were like, yeah, this validates what I know. There were a couple of surprises. Let's talk about so-and-so. Or no, actually, I'm feeling much better because I had a conversation with that person's parent, and we've done this, that, and the other thing. It just helped keep the conversation move along. The next step, once they met with the teacher, is to determine, all right, so what are we doing based on our menu of interventions in the building? And really, we conceptualize them as tiers, just like our academic supports, going from tier one to two to three. Tier one's been kind of fun, where we've added a lot of interesting things, like because there are smart boards or projectors in classrooms, our teachers are starting to use websites like Go Noodle, where there's a lot of movement breaks or interesting, like quick stops to like exercise your body and your brain. One of the buildings, Leeds Elementary School, had their PE teacher collaborated and made some videos of some students doing Tabatas, which is out of CrossFit. But they had kids in the building take videos of themselves doing, so many seconds of a particular exercise and then breaks. And they, the teachers play those on the board in class. And it's neat because it's the kids themselves doing these exercises. And they were created based on the developmental appropriateness of the physical capabilities of the kids. So every grade level might have a different approach. I think a lot of you know we use responsive classroom in some of our buildings. Second step is a really important curriculum that we have in a lot of our buildings. Acting with purpose is one that folks are trying out at Ryan Road this year. What's been really interesting this year is we have used programs like Zones of Regulation or some of the work by Michelle Garcia Winner with some of our students who receive interventions. And what folks are finding is it's really helpful to start using some of that language in the classroom so that when kids do need extra help, you're not creating a new language around social-emotional supports or how to take a break. It's already part of their language. It's part of the custodian's language. It's part of the bus driver's language. It's part of the principal's language. So that's happening in some of our buildings. They're really trying that out this year in some of the classrooms. Tier two, we're really talking about short-term groups, like short-term social skills groups for kids who don't need an intensive level of ongoing support, targeted short-term work in classroom groups for self-regulation or attention or hyperactivity. And more teachers are using sensory spaces and sensory boxes and tools in their rooms, which is really great to see. It's actually becoming more and more of a tier one strategy that pretty much anybody has access to. Tier three is more of what we've been thinking about for a very long time, and what Lori and I have worked with for a long time is that really the more intense level of individual support or counseling support through an IEP children who might have specific behavior plans, and the more targeted work, like I mentioned earlier. So, I'm done talking for a little while, and Lori's going to go.
There are a couple of things that enabled us to really go deeper and to be more planful about our work in social-emotional learning. One of them was the Safe and Supportive Schools Grant, which we received last year. And that was a $20,000 grant that allowed us to do self-assessments at the elementary schools and middle school around what our level of need was in social-emotional learning, and then to do a lot of brainstorming and create a plan for how we wanted to move forward. So what it did was it paid for staff to put in that time after school hours to in large teams from each building that included classroom teachers, ESPs and administrators, some related service providers, and they sat together for hours doing the self-assessment, and then the whole group came together to share their outcomes from the self-assessment, which was a tool that the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education gave to us with the grant, and then to develop a plan to move forward. So some of the things that we developed or that were talked about in that plan was to do resource mapping, which has begun, to develop more extensive community and family relationships, to create a resource library, and so the other thing that happened, and to prioritize social emotional learning through the collection of data, which you've already seen. The other grant that enabled us to spend a lot of time or to put a greater level of effort and funds into this is a grant that comes and goes in the Department of Elementary and Secondary Ed, and that's a Special Education Professional Development Grant. What this has enabled us to do in the last couple of years was to do extensive work in the area of anxiety as it appears in a school setting through grades K to 12. We've done parent trainings, we've done a lot of training of staff and a lot of case presentations, case examinations with an expert in the area of children and anxiety. We have also begun to really try to look at critically at different tools to use in the classrooms, and that's again a focus of our work this year, is to look at the different tools that we're using and to line ourselves up at the elementary level and then moving into secondary about the different ways we want to do interventions and again teaching in the classroom level around social emotional learning. So some additional steps, and I've spoken a little bit about this already. Oh,
I can do it.
The tech person, she presses the button. I've spoken a lot about some of this already. Some of the other things that we're doing and that are part of our plan and part of the things that we're either expanding on or learning more about are trauma-sensitive teaching. We had our first set of workshops on that in November. And I already mentioned our work with Lynn Lyons and anxiety. Gwen has done some training for district-wide now in the use of mindfulness in classrooms, and certainly Jackson Street provides a great model for that work. I think I've spoken really about all the other pieces that we've done, except for mentioning the huge amount of training that we've done using the Crisis Prevention Institute model. Crisis Prevention Institute was first put out a number of years ago as the model to use in restraint training. And now it's really morphed into how to de-escalate students, and that is the primary focus of their training. And Kelly Knight and Jillian Fahmy are our district trainers, and last year and this year have trained in the vicinity of 50 to 60 people in the district in that, which is a huge commitment and gives us a lot of resources in each of our buildings. Again, over time, and these are things that people have known through looking at our budget, we've added more counselors, psychologists, and BCBA time. BCBA is board certified behavior analyst. Our tiered support folks are our building-based supports for students that need additional help with behavior or just being more stable during the school day. So the big question is, on a day-to-day basis, in your classrooms, in our classrooms, in our buildings, why does this feel insufficient? So the next piece of our presentation is really a lot about data. And it's data that reminds us of why we're working so hard to help students. So we have almost 600 students on IEPs and another 167 students with 504 plans. I mean, the numbers are right there. That total of 885 students, that's a lot of our student body. And you can feel that when you're in a classroom. Our school adjustment counselors are seeing a significant increase in the number of students they see, and we're not just talking about those students I'm referring to in the first bullet. These are students that are regular education students. They have no stated, formalized plans or needs, but just the overall level of need for checking in with an adult, talking with someone about things that are going on in your life has increased significantly. Another place that we've seen that, and this is the last bullet, is in our nurses' offices. Just in the first 3 months of school, this year, so September, October, November, the nurses are reporting 571 students specifically coming to nurses' offices for mental health concerns. And they track through their documentation the amount of time that they spend with each one of those students. So spending a lot of time with that data, I averaged it out, and that represents about 190 hours of nurse time. A little bit more data. We just got some data tonight on the number of homeless students and students in foster care ranked and related to statewide. So, and this isn't on that slide. We are number 58 in FY16 for students in foster care. So we had 37 students last year in foster care. Last year we had 53 homeless students. We were ranked number 52nd in the state, and that's out of 372 districts. As I said at the beginning, we are seeing far more students entering hospitals or participating in the Bay State Partial Hospitalization Program. Last year there were 26, there are 15 so far this year. And we are about a third of the way through the year. 55 students with DCF involvement, that's, again, we are looking at these numbers and it's, you know, we can look at one number or this number or that number, but the way it plays out in a classroom is pretty significant. And I think that is, I don't want to undo this. So we I think we've kind of gone over a lot of this, but what we're doing to address a lot of those issues is we are increasing our level of training in social-emotional learning, as we've talked about. We're really examining in-class programs. We're trying to figure out how we can utilize the staff that we have, the faculty and staff that we have, and where our budget is in the best way possible to meet this level of need. And so what it's really asking us to do is to think creatively and to think differently about how we work with our student body as a whole in order to have the best outcomes possible.
This is our fancy graphic that isn't in your slides, but Lori wanted it to be moving parts, but I'm not that clever. So.
And I'm not at all that clever.
So this is a classroom. What we did is we took some of the data and we extracted it to try to create a typical classroom of 20 students in the Northampton schools. Knowing that there's definitely some overlap in many of these categories, and certainly not every classroom looks like this. But when you look at it, if you start on the top left, we have about five students in that class that have either an IEP or a 504 plan.
We have about four students that spend a considerable amount of time visiting the nurse.
On the left, you'll see 7% don't have formal plans, but have visited a counselor.
5% or one student is living with some sort of extraordinary circumstances, and those are the students that we grouped as homeless, students that have DCF involvement, are in foster care, or are living, or are part of a care affidavit, mm-hmm. which it means that they are not living with their family of origin. They are living with either a grandparent, an aunt or an uncle, or perhaps a family friend, and there's formal paperwork done to allow that to happen.
We mentioned this earlier, but just to see the visual of five students in that class would have some elevated level on the strengths and difficulties questionnaire at the elementary level.
And one of the students is an English learner. So again, not all of our classrooms look like this, but it is pretty remarkable when we see teachers working so hard to teach at the same time they are helping students to learn about how to manage themselves, how to manage their thoughts and their emotions, and to relate to their peers.
On the next page, it shows the presentations that have happened, and also there's a link to an article that was in the Gazette last year that talked about the initiatives at the elementary levels. I want to preface this by saying that the article focuses on Leeds. It interviewed folks over at Leeds. But a lot of the things that were happening at Leeds at the time were happening in other buildings also. But it was nice to see some of their work highlighted like that. Bridge Street School is participating formally in the Inclusive Schools Week. Mayor was there earlier this week to kick that off. And at a time when we're involved in an initiative like that, we really want to commit to the understanding that our schools are welcome and capable of educating all of our children. We really have to remain steadfast in this commitment and recognize that in order to meet our students' needs, we need to be flexible and willing to think differently. We need to be thoughtful about how we can educate and support our students who, as I said earlier, are playing chess in a hurricane. And I think I've talked about this a little bit with folks over the last few days is think about how you feel in your own life on a day when some things are just not going great, right? Your car broke down, you found out that a parent or a loved one fell and got injured, your child is sick, somebody's having some major stressors at work, and how that affects you in your work every day. How you feel, how you're able to focus, how you're able to prioritize the work that you're doing every day. And that's what a lot of our students experience. I think the other thing to think about, though, are what skills have you developed over time that help you get through those hard times? And those are the pieces that are really important for us to teach our students.
So we want to leave you with the picture that we just painted, but also with hope. And Pam found this, I think.
Kathy Casale found this.
Kathy Casale is our go-to person for quotes and videos. And I think this is lovely. The future of any society depends on its ability to foster the healthy development of the next generation. And now we also have a little video on social emotional learning that we'd like to share.
Social emotional skills are the essential skills for success in school, work, and life. Emotional learning centers their mind and body. It reduces their emotional tension so they can be open to new content and material. You find that academic outcomes increase exponentially when students are nurtured, loved, and cared for, that we get much more out of them when we first address social emotional needs. So for us, it's actually an academic intervention and not just an emotional one.
If we expect students to be college and career ready, it's important for us to focus on these skills and competencies: self-awareness, self-management, social awareness, relationship skills, and responsible decision-making. Self-awareness is the ability to identify your emotions, to be able to tie thoughts and feelings to behaviors. We find that self-awareness is one of the hardest things for young people, being aware of their own body space and the impact of their words and emotions on other people. So a lot of work we do is reflective through conflict mediation, through circles, through journaling, having them see their own impact on the world, and then how to shift that or make a different choice next time. Self-management is the ability to self-motivate, to have self-control, to regulate one's emotions. In the classroom, that may be a breathing exercise, or that might be counting five or taking a break.
So with students who don't really know how to deal with their anger or don't really know how to resolve conflict, we're giving them a tool that helps them deal with it in a less stressful way.
Social awareness is about embracing diversity, showing empathy for others. Activities might include service learning projects, addressing social justice issues. Role-playing is a great opportunity for students to address how a person might have felt in a conflict on the playground.
We're going to see if other people have had some of the very same experiences around bullying that we've had.
You're in my boat if you have a bully now.
Well, I see a lot of people.
Relationship skills are important in project-based learning. It's the ability to work cooperatively with someone to resolve conflict.
It's the one skill you need your whole life. You may not need calculus tomorrow, but you have to know how to work in a relationship, whether it's for a coworker or a life partner. You have to know how to handle conflict and how to handle challenges.
Sometimes at recess, Maya would come over and like just start talking about us and saying mean things.
Is it your job to make Danae's job at school hard?
I know it's a form of bullying, and sometimes I'll say sorry to her.
So you choose to be someone's ally and make a better choice.
Responsible decision making is considering the well-being for self and others. It's evaluating the consequences for various behaviors or actions. We do this through shared agreements, one-to-one problem solving, or having students debate an issue.
If you were like, hey, Kushida, can I, how much does an A cost in this class? And you like took out your wallet and, you know, and I was like, 50 bucks would work. Which one of us would be corrupt in that case?
You're the one that's asking for the money?
We're truly teaching these students to be productive citizens. We're teaching them life skills. We're teaching them how to problem solve effectively. We're teaching them how to be resilient.
I think of all the billions of dollars we've spent on Title I and all these intervention programs, and when all is said and done, what do we have to show for it? I think we're trying to teach technical things instead of devoting some of the resources to teach who you are as a person. Once you know who you are, then learning becomes exciting because you've already established a discipline.
It's important for teachers and principals to understand that it can't be a binder off the shelf. It can't be something that happens from 2:15 to 4:30 on Tuesdays and Thursdays. It has to be part of the school culture.
Giving teachers flexibility, giving them a range of skills, giving them different ways that it can look, and allowing them to take their own personality and match that to what they want in their classroom has been the best way to get authentic, true practice.
If we continue to do what we've always done, we're always going to get what we always got. Is that good enough? I don't think it's good enough for the 21st century. We need to be the outliers to try things that have never been tried and see if they work. What are we waiting for?
So thank you for your attention, and should we ask for questions? Or?
Thank you both. Are there questions or comments from Mr. Meyer?
So my first question is, are these problems that are getting worse, or are we just, is this, we have better your experience?
So I've been doing this about 30 years, and I have not seen such young children be hospitalized, go into partial, be as dysregulated as we see them. That is in some ways for me the thing that strikes me the most, to see a kindergartner or a preschooler that needs to be hospitalized. And I do think it's more significant. The amount of, and I hate to refer it to money, but the amount of money we spend on tutoring for home hospital for kids who are unable to come into the buildings because they're anxious or depressed or whatever it happens to be, but in some ways their mental health status is impacting them so significantly that they can't come into the building. That's much more significant. When I was a principal, we'd have one of those students in a year, but it's far more than one now. So I think we can point to a bunch of different, you know, areas and say, I don't know if you have any that you want to kind of point out, Pam.
Yeah, I guess the other thing I'd like to say is it really does cut across socioeconomic status and class and race, and you know, we don't have the exact numbers for everything, but certainly anecdotally we talk about it quite a lot. I mean, families of all types are impacted pretty tremendously with kids with significant mental health concerns, whether acutely or chronic. The amount of time that our principals that would want for things, it varies. I mean, 60 was like...
the most.
Yeah.
That was an average.
60% spending time on social emotional needs every day was a pretty good day.
There's one.
Sure, yeah.
What strikes me is that, you know, if it's increased, there could be causes that are external to the schools, and there also could be causes that are internal. And just thinking in the last 20 years how education has changed, and even in a video that was talking about social emotional health, which could be the end of the conversation, there was still this reference to it will improve their performance, which seems to me sad.
To get people's attention, unfortunately.
Yeah. Right. No, but I mean, that's again, everything is a means to an end. And I'm wondering, you know, obviously not for the preschoolers and kindergartners because they haven't had the exposure, but for our middle school and high school students where every day in school is a measurement of performance. And again, that's we can't do so much to change the external stuff, but restructuring our environment within our schools is something we can do.
You said it. I don't think there's a response to that. I'm sorry to. I don't mean to be.
Ms. Bisansky.
Well, first, thank you both for this presentation. I learned a lot, and thanks for all the hard work that you're doing on this. I just had a couple questions. I was kind of curious what's happening at the high school level. There was a lot of talk about elementary school, a little bit about middle school, but what happens at the high school on this?
In terms of student need or in terms of support?
In terms of student need first, how do you identify students? It sounds like this STQ is happening at the, you said at the elementary school, and now it's just starting at the middle school, but it's not being done at the...
So there are steps, it was easy to start at the elementary school because we could ask teachers to do the work there. And I hope we kind of continue on into the high school. But certainly... our two adjustment counselors at the high school are beyond busy. I mean, they are, so one person has seen, at this point in the year, a third of the way through the year, has seen half as many kids as were seen in the entire year last year. And the other person has a caseload of 75 students who are on IEPs who have counseling services on their IEPs. That's almost untenable. just say it is.
So are you going to be implementing this SDQ evaluation at the high school level?
We're still trying to figure out how to do that. They do surveys at the high school already on substance abuse and other things, so there's a question of like not wanting to over-survey kids, and we're in the middle of figuring out like the timing that would be right and if there's some overlap with some surveys they already do.
And working with Karen Jarvis Vance on that, because a lot of her surveys and a lot of her data gathering happens at the high school. Mm-hmm. And she provided us with a good chunk of the data that we use tonight.
And are you, sorry, I'm just going to go on this
train
of thought. So is Lens 21 connected to this at all? Are you familiar with Lens 21 at all? What's happening?
I've heard a little bit about it, but I'm not at the high school.
I don't even know that much about it. Do you, Dr. Provost?
Sure. It is related to accreditation. High schools.
Social-emotional.
Well, it does have social-emotional, but high schools need to identify their learning expectations as part of the accreditation process in a way to explicitly teach those learning expectations. So Lens 21 is the program that the high school is using to embed those expectations across the curriculum.
Right, and it happens with their first period teacher, and my understanding is that first period teacher does make some assessment of their social emotional well-being, I guess. Maybe, is that accurate?
It's changed now, and I'm sure Mr. Lombardi could talk about this more, but it's now across the board, all teachers, and it's implemented into the teacher's syllabus. So it's not a teacher assessing individual students one-on-one, from my understanding. It's kind of goals of collaboration and communication across the board that they're implementing into their curriculum.
Anyway, I just wonder if there's any kind of opportunity, at least how it ran last year, with being able to have sort of first period teachers maybe do this assessment. I think there's a lot of students, as you've just said yourself, at the high school level who really, are in need. I know in particular that this year's senior class lost one of their classmates freshman year, and I think there's a lot of kids who still suffer from the student having taken her life. And I know you feel the responsibility, the weight of that responsibility to do something and make sure that we're kind of addressing
our kids need. So I guess I would just urge you all to really pay attention to this at the high school level. And I know you're sort of on your way, and it's a process and it's steps. I'm not.
No. I think
do really feel concerned for our high school students.
Of the responsibility is, it's kind of in our face every single day throughout the day. Pam and I attend really the toughest, and Barbara, really the toughest team meetings in the district. And so we see students who are really, students who are benefiting from special ed or 504 plans, but we also see students who are really suffering. Mm-hmm. And it's, we were talking tonight at some point when we were both driving home about how it's hard not to cry when we talk about this.
Yeah, I agree. I wonder if, you kind of started the presentation by saying that teachers were really the best kind of person to be involved, to help a student in this situation. And I'm just curious how many high school teachers have been trained or...
So all of the staff throughout the district did the trauma training at that we did in November. And I'm just trying to remember the
There's
other
some really great trainings. Work that's happening at the middle school around anxiety, and it's sort of spreading.
Oh, and the high school,
like,
too.
Pockets.
So when Lynn Lyons first came to the district, she did a two-day session that was attended by pretty much all of our school adjustment counselors, school psychologists, a bunch of special ed teachers. There were about 35 people at the training. And then she's done a few parent nights that a lot of teachers have attended, and our case conferences. So, it's happening in pockets, and we just need to keep working to get to everyone and to make it deep enough so it becomes part of their inner toolbox as they're teaching.
But it gets at the need, which showed in the self-assessment, the need for more professional development in this area. And on professional development days, it is like just trying to figure out how much to squeeze into that time. But people are begging for it at this point. And not just professional development, like a one-shot thing. Also, like rich conversations, lengthy conversations, time to collaborate as a team about kids, about problem solving around these issues. Really, that's where we see the most benefit. It isn't like a one-shot deal at all.
Yeah.
And we've seen some successes. Last year, Kathy Casal had a book group at the high school with some teachers. So more and more people are finding time to fill their brains with information like this.
Thank you. Thanks again.
Ms. Burnham?
I just wanted to make a very quick comment that I really appreciate the teachers on this, that the conflict, of course, is coming from these two opposing forces that we've touched upon, and the academic expectations versus, and needing to get through a certain amount of curriculum, and the emotional challenge of teachers to have this curriculum and be dedicated to teaching teaching that, and that parents want that, and to also be able to hold this emotional piece is really, really, really a tremendous is a tremendous thing. And I also think, to reflect on the high school piece, that this is sort of the basic premise of early childhood education as well. And I think that any of those that those abilities to mix and match our teachers will also bring such benefit, because I mean, this is the anchor of early childhood.
Yeah, there's this department actually has a document on preschool and kindergarten social emotional standards.
Right.
And when we looked through it with the counselors and the psychologists one day, it was like,
it was the same.
they're the same ones for seniors. It's the exact same thing. It's just done a little differently.
It's just done a little differently.
Yeah.
Dr. Barrett?
So I think all of us have read about how this is really like a national trend, not local, not regional. In any of your research, have you brought any information about this being an international trend, or is this more?
Oh, good question. I don't. I haven't done that research yet. I mean, it's tricky because so many countries outside of ours don't really look at special education, don't really look at, or look very differently at special needs or student needs. I have a colleague who went to Abu Dhabi as just to introduce special education mm-hmm. because they had no idea what it was about. And that was only 2 or 3 years ago. So it would be an interesting thing to look at, and then there's all the cultural pieces that play into that too. But that's a really interesting question to raise.
Go ahead.
I just wanted to reflect a little bit more on the high school thing, and I appreciate Ms. Buzanski for bringing this up. And as I was watching your presentation, I was reflecting on the fact that a lot of the intervention, specifically with this survey, had to do with teachers. And at the elementary level, you have one teacher who's with you for the whole day. At JFK, you have a team of teachers that all experience that one kid. And I worry quite a bit about high school students slipping through the cracks. There doesn't seem to be a teacher that knows all of the students in one specific group. So I guess I'm wondering how you're working on tailoring these methods like the survey, which I don't know how that would fit on a high school level when there's not that teacher component to it.
So at that level, you really would do the self-assessment. The students would do it themselves, just like they did at the middle school. But then again, it's just one piece of having a conversation about students and saying, okay, that student reports this, but self-reports, a lot of kids who have social-emotional difficulties under-report. So it might be under-reported, but then you also might see that they have 20 absences by this time this year. And that sort of gets that conversation starting. But it is really hard to imagine a teacher being able to capture.
And that's the reason I think that I depend on, as the part of our student services team that works the most at the high school, I depend on the team of the three administrators plus guidance and the two school adjustment counselors and the special ed teachers. And a lot of times, like today, we met about a student, and there were eight of us at the table. And because we all had a different piece, you know, kind of like the story of the blind man and the elephant, we all saw different pieces of this student's story. And I think, and we bring different strengths to that story and different skills. So I do think it's complicated at the high school, not that it's not at preschool or elementary or middle school, but it's a flatter picture of, if you look at like organizational structure, it's a flatter picture of who goes where and does what. And so you really have to throw out a wide net to get the information.
And a reality of doing screening like this is that once you've committed to gathering the data, you've also committed to doing something about it, right? And so gathering data that might, who knows how many students are, it's a real commitment for our teachers who have jumped into this and to say, oh wow, so we might find out whatever, and once we know, we gotta do something. And it's not like they didn't know beforehand, but it just you see it differently when you start collecting the data.
Yes, go ahead.
Thank you, this is lovely. And I love what Downey said too, just to frame this in terms of what's changed in public education. I also think we as educators need to understand trauma and anxiety and racism, actually, I think has a role in this. As staff, we need to talk about that. But there's a dissonance for me a little bit. And it's just more of a, are you keeping an eye on this? When you're talking about the high school and the social emotional needs, and we had a presentation last week about a structural change in the high school. I'm hoping that you're keeping an eye on that to see if that was a good change, given what you're seeing.
So we are meeting about that next week.
Awesome. Okay.
Yeah, we're having a brainstorming session next week to look at how things have gone this semester,
yeah.
or are going this semester. Who are the outliers, who's still struggling, who needs more, and who's coming, who might be raising up, you know, rising, whatever, with more need, and who's doing really well with mm-hmm. the structure. So those are the questions that Brian and I actually talked about this morning.
Good.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Ms. Fallon.
I guess I was hoping you could talk a little bit about the financial piece, because the Safe and Supportive Schools grants run out, and I understand that it's free according to that, you know, to get to do the surveys and all that, but I'm assuming there's some sort of cost that you'll be incurring. Are there other grants available? Can you use other funds for it? Or is it just a matter of you need to fund more positions?
All of the above. So first of all, we have this year's 274 grant, which is specifically for social emotional learning. I mean, it's not a huge amount, but it's going to allow us to do a bunch of training, as well as to get some samples of curriculums and try them out with guidance and coaching. And it also allows us to pay people to stay later to do some of that planning work and brainstorming work. I think one of the reasons I felt a sense of urgency about presenting this information at this time of year is we are about to start budgeting, and our work as an administrative team in thinking kind of from the bottom up of our budgets, and I always like to think kind of with a blank sheet about budget. What do we really need? Do we need to think differently about how we're using staff, how we're using our funds? Because some of the things that we're doing are not sustainable. It's not sustainable for a school adjustment counselor to have a caseload of 75. I will probably call out somebody else in this room. It is not sustainable for Kelly Knight to work 12 hours a day, 5 days a week, as our only social worker. Those kinds of things help the system, but then, I mean, it's when I hire people, I think, well, does that person have good boundaries? Do I want them to like only work 40 hours a week, or do I want them to want to work 50 hours a week? But then after a point, that's not sustainable anymore, and you're hurting the people that you depend on and who really create the positive culture that you want to sustain. So that's my lecture on budget.
I think one of the greatest parts of having the grant, even though it was to do the self-assessment, was just that people were paid to talk about this stuff, and it was so beneficial. And they said just having the time to feel like you could, without worrying about your child care and all that other stuff, you actually were being paid to like sit and just focus on this topic for a while, and kids and what we need, and it was very beneficial.
It was a gift. We were one of 10 districts that got the grant out of, I think it was 63 applicants. Unfortunately, we didn't get it this year, but.
So you can reapply for it?
Well, we did.
Not even in the future?
Yeah. Well, if they, you know, it's hard to say what grants they'll have each year. I look for them.
Any other questions or comments? Thank you both.
Thank you so much.
Next, we have a vote on a gift. This is a gift of the Henry and Margaret Shriver Family Trust to the Elementary School Garden Projects, and I believe Mary Bates is here to talk about it.
It's nice to see you all. I am the unofficial coordinator of our district elementary school garden program. We have gardens at all four elementary schools, and I'm here to request acceptance of a gift to our four elementary schools in the amount of $4,000 by the Henry and Margaret Shriver Family Trust. Bob Hanna, who's the trustee, taught in the Northampton Public Schools for many years, for about 15 years, and he also served as the IT coordinator of the district for 4 years, ending in the year 2000. So his family, he's donating on behalf of his family funds, and as the trustee, funds in memory of his aunt and mother to support our outdoor garden classrooms at each of our elementary schools in the amount of $1,000 per school for a total of $4,000 to the district. His aunt, Margaret Shriver, was a Northampton resident for almost 50 years, and she was instrumental in the creation of the Smith College Summer School for Social Work Summer Program, where she worked for many years. And she was also a longtime community supporter and advocate, particularly of the elderly, and was involved with the Lathrop community on Bridge Road. And she and her sister, Bob Hanna's mother, put together a family foundation, and Bob Hanna is continuing their community work in Florida, working with garden programs there, and he is now contributing, or his family trust is contributing to our garden program in Northampton. So this gift is a really wonderful boost to our district elementary garden program, outdoor garden classroom program, and we request your acceptance.
Okay.
Make a motion to accept the gift, the Henry and Margaret Shiver Family Trust $4,000 to the elementary school garden project. With gratitude. Thank you very much.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Motion seconded. Any discussion? Any comments? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Bates. Okay, the next item, we have a report from the Rules and Policy Subcommittee and with some second readings and votes, and I will turn it over to the chair, Ms. Fallon, who's freshly back from Hawaii. Welcome back. Vicariously through your travels.
So the report, I was hoping we could... I'm trying to remember what the report exactly was. I know that we had referred, it had been referred to us, the subcommittee. I was planning on skipping it, but you just said we have a report, so. Okay, then I'm not going to report.
Okay.
I'm going to report next month.
Okay.
What we're going to do is we're going to talk about the newly created, we've been required to create a policy regarding the charge and collection of payment for school meals. This is the second reading, and we'll be voting on it. It's file EFDA. I'm not going to reread it because I read it last month in its entirety to you. But it has charging procedures listed. If you have any questions, I know our food service director has stayed this entire time.
Okay. Okay. Any questions? And Mr. Trenfoglia is here to answer any questions.
I
ask a question since you're here.
Since I'm here.
Sure.
Hello, everyone.
Hello. Welcome. I'm going to support this on your recommendation. It came to us several months ago and identified that our school district really is in need of some sort of charge policy. My concern still remains with part of this policy that speaks to how we go about collecting negative balances of students. And so I know that we're going to be making every possible opportunity available to parents and students to try to collect and make it possible for them to pay. I don't know of many or any other type of institutions that allow folks to charge and then potentially not pay back the balance for whatever reason it might be. And the concern I have with it is simply that there is no cap placed on how many reimbursable lunches or how many regular school lunches can be charged and continue to accrue a negative balance. So I guess just before we take the vote, maybe you could share with us how it's going, or if you know any current numbers as to how far, you know, in the red we are as far as not collecting on debt.
Of course, as I mentioned before, it's kind of an organic thing where it goes up and it goes down, and it all depends on how money starts to flow and a lot of times our approach and attack. If we make a robocalls, or in this instance, how we've changed a little bit and having principals helping us out, we'll see an influx of money, and then it spikes back up, so it comes back and forth. Currently, right now, this year, we're at about $6,200 deficit of money that needs to come back into the program. I'm hopeful in the approach of having principals and their assistants help in trying to get the word out to those parents and trying to contact. So far, we've done okay with that. And they've been very helpful. They've really been aggressively trying to help with that. I think we just have to really kind of keep on it. And really, I think the big picture becomes where it will stay at each year and the families that become more of the problem each year if they're the same families. That's a little bit of what I see is the numbers that get high within families sometimes will be the same family from year to year. That's always a concern because, you know, the normal, excuse me for saying that, the families that, okay, I forgot to pay a little while, and then they throw the money back in and they have plenty of money, then it drops down a little bit. That's just kind of a wave. It's the families that just choose not to pay year to year of what to do with that and who don't qualify for free and reduced. I think that's a big key. Who just, they may have filled out an application and they weren't approved for it, and yet they still choose not to pay. So we have some families that are like that. I think having a policy in place is something that once we get it out to the families and they kind of know where it's at, it can be beneficial to a certain degree that at least we have something in place that this is what we do. Just have to keep trying to go at it with a firm hand, I guess.
I know that this is something that's relatively new to our district, this ability to be able to charge in this fashion, and I'm in support of it. I'm wondering now with your staff, have you noticed an increase of labor hours placed towards trying to make these collections, and is it impacting the amount of productivity that you would have expected out of your help in other areas of the office?
With last year being my first year, and last year being the first year we really aggressively kind of attacked it, I don't really have a way to look at whether it's more or has increased. I know our approach has increased this year, and I know that there is some labor hours that will be involved in doing that. I'm hoping that the principals and their assistants helping will alleviate some of that from the food service side of things. But I think across the board, we still have to aggressively talk to parents and get information out to parents as much as possible without trying to overwhelm them. I mean, if someone gets 5 bills in the course of a month from different areas, sometimes they just go, oh, I'm overwhelmed with it. So I'm trying to find the balance within that. But my staff do put in hours, and not minutes, but hours, in trying to capture the funds where it could be used for something else. So it's more of a plea to parents to try to keep up as best as they can, or just simply contact us so we can have a discussion. I think that's the big thing. I'd love to be able to just have discussions with families to say, what can we do to help you, and what can we do to help us, and how can we make this all work together to make it easy? It's when we're trying to track down funds and they're getting up to $300, $400, and $500 plus that we say, well, what can we do here? We're trying everything that we can. So we will definitely keep at it for sure.
Dr. Baird?
So how much time is it taking for principals to try to collect the money?
I really haven't talked with them. Just looking at the breakdown from each school, there's some schools that are upwards of $30 at a level threshold that they're making the phone calls or sending out letters. A letter was drafted in the beginning when we started talking about this that all the principals are using right now. I believe some of them are making phone calls. It's really a choice of what they're looking to do, but it's really coming more directly from the principals. I don't think that it's a lot of time. But again, it's still time. It's still time that they're utilizing for this. But it has been helpful because parents have called. On a principal side, parents have called and said, we received this phone call, and I know I didn't do it. So we received this phone call, and we would like to find out what we can do or who we can pay. Hasn't been many, but it has been helpful.
Ms. Fallon?
I was just gonna say, the whole process, I was so impressed by you being there and the principals and really trying to find a policy that was respectful towards families and helped to identify families who may need help and red flags. And And my concern, I said, I don't want the principals to, you know, I know you're so stressed out. And they said, no, we want to be involved in this. Like, we want to make the calls, because I was worried about their time. And they were like, no, we should be involved in this process, and reach out to families and find out, you know, what's going on and if we can help. So I was worried about it, and I'd be interested to hear how long it was, but that they were the ones who took that on themselves, most certainly. So.
And a quick little side note to that, it can be helpful for this type of information to be shared with principals and them stepping in, because it can also show things in other areas that they may not have caught.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions?
So this is eligible for a vote this meeting. Do you want to make a motion?
I guess before you do that, so I would, the only thing I
talk faster.
You should have. The only thing that I would say is we're going to be hearing later on from our business administrator, you know, the financial situation that we're finding ourselves in right now, with some freezes going on throughout the district and trying to find money in order to cover some of the overages. And so as we look at this, and I'm sure we're going to approve this, this is one of the areas where when there's a deficit at the end of the year, part of this policy states that it goes back to the general fund. And so this is another bill that needs to be settled by the end of the year, and we'll be looking to try to find funds to cover this debt. So I think I'm praying we'll be okay this year, and hopefully in close years to come. But these are the types of things that I've learned over time sitting on this committee, that it really accumulates to a point where we have to make hard decisions in regards to services that we vote and offer here in the district, and trying to reel in as many as we can and keep the numbers down as low as we can is the only way that we can continue to sustain and have the vibrant programs we have here in our district.
Move to
that said, go.
I'd like to make a motion to approve policy EFDA, charge and collection of payments for school meals.
Second.
Okay. Been a motion made and seconded. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
The policy is approved. Next, we have a required vote to surplus space at the Northampton High School for a cable access television lease, and I'll turn it over to Ms. Walczak.
Okay. If we think back to last spring, the 10-year contract that the school department had with NCTV was coming to an expiration, but because there had been substantial turnover in everybody that was involved, it wasn't on anyone's radar. So by the time we realized the lease would be running out shortly, there was not time to do a bid. So what we did, working with the city attorney and NCTV, was we did an extension. We came to you last year. You voted to surplus for a period of 16 months, rather. That space, we have to go through the city council and Department of Ed, and then we executed a lease extension with NCTV, taking them through August of 2017. What we want to do now is get started early on an actual bid. The bid has not been put together. There will be further discussion with you down the road, but we're anticipating it will probably be similar to the last lease, which was a 10-year period. And again, looking for somebody who will run a cable TV access channel in Northampton. So at this point, we're asking the school committee to vote to surplus the space that is currently used by NCTV. We will then ask the city council to do the same thing and send the request to Department of Ed to approve that. And at the same time, we'll be drafting up the bid documents, working with Central Services to go out to bid for the next round of leasing.
Make a motion to surplus space at Northampton High School for cable access TV.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion on that? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. So that surplus vote carries. The next item is a gift from the NHS PTO, $250 in fall teacher grants.
$2,250. Yes. Attached to your backup is a list of five gifts that the high school PTO is making to different groups at the high school. To run through them quickly, there's $750 for the college fair for juniors, $200 for college readiness for juniors and seniors, $500 for kitchen equipment and starting up a gardening program, $250 for student art exhibit and an opening reception at Forbes Library, and then $550 for touring theater production. So the PTO is doing these. They also are working some additional gifts where they'll probably be making some direct payment for things, and those will be reported to you in the future as they happen. This is a cash donation that will be turned over to us to fund the programs that we just talked about.
Make a motion to accept the gift, NHS PTO $2,250 in fall teacher grants.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. Moving on, another set of gifts. This is a gift from NHS PTO, $2,000 to the NHS band.
Exactly that. It's a general donation to the band to be able to use for some of their operating costs in the amount of $2,000.
Make a motion to accept the gift, NHS PTO, $2,000 to the NHS band.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, that gift is accepted. Next, we have a vote on a requested budget transfer to create an ESP position at JFK Middle School.
Yeah, we've actually already heard several references tonight about how tight the budget is and how we're needing to move money around. In the past month or so, a need for an additional ESP has been recognized at JFK Middle School. There was not funding in any of the personnel accounts that would cover this, so there's some recommendation here of transfers out of three different accounts, some of them being expenses at the building level, that would be moved in to fund the bulk of the ESP costs. And there is a small balance in some of the ESP payroll accounts that will be added to this. The total cost is probably closer to $17,000. So we're asking you to approve the three transfers listed here to fund the 12,000 and change for the CSP position. And it does create another position in the budget, which is why it's actually coming to you.
Make a motion on the budget transfer to create JFK ESP position.
Second.
Okay. Any questions or discussions about this? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. Next are another set of budget transfers for staff changes and to cover budget deficits.
We did the same process last year with some substantial changes. So the budget is obviously done in the spring, school starts in the fall, and we make a number of changes based on the needs of kids and things like the demographics of the community. One of the examples on here is we had budgeted for an additional kindergarten teacher in ESP at Leeds School. As we looked at enrollment numbers through July and August, it appeared we needed to put that position at Bridge rather than Leeds. So two of the transfers on here are to move the money from Leeds into Bridge. So we did the same type of transfers last year for adjustments. The biggest change this year possibly is the last section, which are the transfer balances from staff turnover. We had some money left, and moving that in to cover deficits in the special ed budget. And I think, as my report to you mentions later, in addition to, this is about $108,000 here being moved into special ed tuition accounts. We also have $70,000 that we froze earlier this year, or take back. You can use whatever word you like, but it was removed from the schools, and it's being held to cover other deficits we're anticipating. I haven't actually recommended that transfer happen yet, because we're gonna leave it in the account where we're holding it. We've removed it from the schools, put it in a holding account within our budget. If it's needed at the end of year for special ed tuitions or other costs, we'll move it there. We'll come back to you for that. But if we're optimistic, we can try to be optimistic that we won't need it, and we'll be returning it to the schools. We can hold on to that hope as we go forward through the budget. But I think this indicates even more so last year how tight the budget is this year.
Dr. Baird.
So when you say you removed it from the schools, what would the schools have spent that money on that they're now not spending?
Things like instructional supplies, professional development, each principal chose where they wanted to. They were given an amount based on what we were looking at overall, and each principal made the decision based on the money they had left at that time and what they thought they could do for the rest of the year. And they I'm not going to say recommended, but they decided which accounts to take the funds out of.
I'll make a motion to make the budget transfers for staff changes and budget deficits.
Is there a second? Second, Ms. Fallon. Any other questions or discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so that transfer is approved.
We'll now move into the business administrator's report, followed by the personnel report.
Yep. So the very first item is, again, that you have the monthly report there with some highlights in terms of the stuff we've already talked about with the condition of the budget, the money that we've held from the schools, and the transfers we just talked about. The second item is just an update for you on the telephone system. We're finally at the point that the new phones are about to go live, hopefully next Thursday night. Training has been happening. Some of the phones are installed and should be put in the schools on Monday. And hopefully it's going to go smoothly, and we'll have new phones that will have access to 911 for every location. We'll have voicemail for every teacher. We'll have voicemails that can be forwarded to emails, if people prefer to do it that way. So we're really moving ahead in terms of the technology, and hopefully by next Friday, this will all be working fine, and I think the city converts over a couple days before us and all the city departments. And then the last piece is just the some additional gifts. There were no PTO gifts this month under $1,000. There were three gifts from non-PTO groups that the superintendent accepted. There was a gift from $500 from the Institute for Training and Development, which was actually given on behalf of a presentation done by Nancy Cheevers and Kathy Casal. So rather than paying them, the donation was made to the school department, and it will actually go into a professional development account to be used for the district. There was a wheelchair transportation donated by Vanpool Transportation with a value about $200 to take students to the Special Olympics at the end of October. And there was a $20 anonymous donation of a gift card to the Bridge Street Library for the purchase of some books there. Personnel report. Short mid-year. We had 7 new hires, some ESPs, and some support staffs, and we had 4 separations, and then 1 retired employee who came back to work in another position for us.
Thank you. We'll now move to Dr. Provost and the superintendent's report.
Thank you. The phrase that I've been using with the ALT team in the week since our last school committee meeting is managing the present while preparing for the future. As you've seen tonight, there are a lot of students in the district who are presenting with real needs, and helping administrators and teachers manage the challenges that they're seeing in front of them really has been a big part of the work of the last several weeks. I also, like Dr. Baird, was interested in trying to get some sense of a larger perspective on what we're experiencing in Northampton. I was not able to go international, but I can tell you there is some national data on this. In 2009, the National Institutes for Health launched its Healthy People Campaign 2020. And part of that campaign focused specifically around mental health. And part of the impetus for the campaign was that there was a real concern about the amount of cost that mental health was introducing into the healthcare system and into the economy at large, never mind trying to run a school budget. So there were 3 indicators in the Healthy People 2020 campaign that were specifically related to children. On all 3 measures, they set a goal saying, let's try to achieve a 10% improvement from the 2009 baseline level. On all 3 measures, things are worse now than they were when they set that goal. So as a country, we're definitely not moving in the right direction with respect to student mental health. And this is a tricky conversation, because sometimes when you try to have this conversation, it introduces anxiety for people. But I think it's an important one to have. Because I don't think I'd be serving the schools or serving the community well if, you know, I didn't acknowledge the realities that were presented tonight. I don't think it's realistic to expect, if we're sitting in the context of a national trend of a mental health worsening of conditions, that Northampton will be insulated from that. So if we see that as a nation, mental health is becoming more of a concern for young people, I think the only future we can project is that mental health become more of a need for the students of the Northampton Public Schools. So I put that out there because I've said all along, we'll be setting ourselves up for disappointment if we think there's going to be some kind of magic fix, or if there's going to be some kind of external intervention that will make it go away. And that includes maintaining fiscal discipline. Some, as you've seen from the transfers, we just talked about $178,000 that were transferred from different accounts into special education, mainly for the purposes of trying to alleviate some of the pressures that schools are feeling. But that pretty much is the extent of the fiscal cards we can play. At this point, there's nothing left. And I think it's really important that we maintain fiscal discipline because, you know, we've seen in neighboring districts, it can lead to disaster if you reach into other accounts or if you borrow from the future in order to try to preserve a situation in the current environment. So, you know, we're doing our best to limit getting into high cost obligations that will reduce our flexibility in the future. And it's something that really has been a big part of messaging to the administrators and messaging to the teachers, and something that I just want to get out to the community as well. It's not that we're withholding funds, it's that we're using every available dollar to the best impact. But as we saw in the presentation tonight, it feels like it's not enough. Also in the category of managing the present, I want to inform the public and the school committee that I have authorized an expenditure from the extraordinary maintenance account for roof repairs over the Leeds kindergarten wing. I'd hoped that this would not be necessary. I don't think truly it's the best way to spend money, because replacing that whole roof is on the list of MSBA projects for the summer. But the situation really has gotten untenable there. We have active drip buckets in all of the classrooms, students sticking their hands in the dip water. So I think we have to make some temporary repairs, especially since now that we're in snow season, even if it's not actively raining out, there'll be a little bit of melting and, you know, the drips just go on. So for the families of young students at Leeds, relief is coming. Now on to planning for the future. I continue to work with the Welcome Home Steering Committee and the School Working Group as we prepare for the refugee resettlement process. At the last meeting, it was shared that progress is being made on the housing front, which always was sort of like the hole in the donut in this whole project. It seems that some reliable, affordable housing has been located. And so we're expecting about 3 families to arrive sometime in the month of January. Another thing is known and allows us to plan for the future. One of the things I have been questioning and concerned about from the beginning is, okay, if year one is 51 refugees, how many in year two? And the commitment right now is to maintain an additional 51 refugees in the second year and not begin to escalate that number until at least the third year. However, getting back to budget, that means really this year we're going to have to make a double request for all of the staff that are necessary to support refugee students, because none of those were built into last year's budget, because refugees didn't become a reality until after the budget process was completed. So in this upcoming year, it's sort of catch up. I have to ask for the positions that I would have needed in order to support refugees in this budget, and ask for the positions they'll need to support the additional refugees that'll be coming in the next school year. So also looking to the future, a team of NPS administrators and staff attended the Future Ready Conference on November 14th. About 2 weeks later, a larger group, including the ALT team, several district teachers, and 2 students, including Elena, completed a Future Ready assessment, looking at the readiness of the district to implement a 21st century digital learning curriculum. You get scored on a scale of 10. We got a 4.2 out of 10. So I think that shows that there's a lot of room for improvement. But I think that taking the assessment was an important first step. A lot of the potential of digital learning, you know, it cuts both ways. I do think that it'll allow for greater voice and a greater choice. It'll allow us to make better adjustments to student needs and better differentiate instruction. But there is something about the 24/7 learning piece that's a little bit nagging, you know, to Mr. Meyer's point. And in fact, to a point that came up yesterday, we were having an informal discussion with a couple of school committee members around homework and, you know, what are realistic expectations for homework? And sort of out of the blue, one of the administrators said, well, the homework piece is only one part. You know, we have kids who are starting now in middle school to build their resumes for college, you know, and why do they think they need to do that? And so when you introduce the possibility of learning at any time, any subject, anywhere, you know, I strongly suspect that we're going to need to also teach students to sort of put some controls on that and not to just, you know, burn themselves out. But it is interesting, and it is a direction that we will continue to move in. We are considered one of the districts that has made the Future Ready pledge to keep trying to figure it out. And I will say that the students who are on that group are very excited about digital learning. So I think for that reason alone, it's worth future consideration. So obviously a big part of getting Future Ready is hiring the DLCS position. I'll just say we've had some discussions. This may be the one last remaining piece of flexibility we have in the budget. I may be recommending that we not fill it immediately to see if we can save some money on salaries there or do something else with the position. But we, the interview committee meeting will be meeting for the first time next week to design the process and then later to review applications and ultimately to bring forward a candidate. We do have a number of applicants, a lot of people who look really good, and I do think that position is really going to help us get from a 4.2 to something closer to a 10. So that's my report.
Thank you. Okay, we have no new business this evening. In terms of future business and meeting dates, we have a special school committee meeting. That's this Monday, December 12th, 6 p.m. at the Northampton Fire Station. This is the professional development. We have rules and policy subcommittee meeting December 15th, 3:30 p.m. in the superintendent's office. Negotiating subcommittee December 21st, 3:30 p.m. at JFK Library. And the school committee meeting January 12th, 2017, here in the JFK Community Room at 7:15 p.m. We will now, I'll now entertain a request to go into executive session.
I make a request for an executive session in JFK Principal's Conference Room under Massachusetts General Law, Open Meeting Law, Chapter 38, Section 21A3, to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining NACE and to discuss strategy with respect to litigation civil action number 15-30156-KAR and Chapter 30A, Section 21A2, to discuss strategy with respect to non-union personnel contract student services director, whereas an open session would have a detrimental effect and further details would compromise the reason for going into executive session.
Can I get a second?
Second.
That motion's been seconded. I would now ask the clerk to call the roll, and folks would respond either in the affirmative or the negative to go into the executive session.
Aye.
Ms.
Becky
Johnson?
Aye.
Ms. Laura Fallon?
Yes.
Ms.
Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Dan Meyer?
Aye.
Mr. Howard?
Yes.
Mr.
Matty? Affirmative.
Yes.
Absolutely.
And
aye. It's
big. Okay. So I need to announce to the public that the school committee will be going into an executive session. Because to have this discussion in public session would be detrimental on the matters that we're discussing. I also need to advise the public that we will be adjourning from executive session and not returning to open session. Thank you.